Good evening. Merry Christmas to each and every one of you. Hope you've had a wonderful time with your family this weekend. What a joy to be able to gather as the church and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. After all, that's what it's all about, isn't it? And we hope that you will enjoy the service tonight. It won't be a long service. It never is, but just to stop and think what it all really means. Before we have our prayer, just want to give you a heads up. Because it is a Sunday, and Christmas doesn't fall on Sunday every year, but after our first congregational hymn, our ushers will come forward, and they'll be taking an offering. But guest, if you are a guest with us, please, that's not for you. That is for our members who want to give their tithes and offerings, so we're giving them that opportunity in our service this evening. Would you bow with me as we have a word of prayer? Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we have gathered here this evening, Lord, to worship you. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, whose birthday we have celebrated this day and we're celebrating this evening in this service. Oh Lord, I pray that we would ever be eager and quick to give a reason for the hope that we have as Christians. Help us to share with those in our community, where we work, where we go to school, that Jesus is the only hope that anyone has. Thank you, Lord, again, for allowing us to be here, be with each person who participates in the service tonight. May everything said and done in this service bring honor and glory to your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Yeah.
Let's all stand as we turn to page 89 and as we sing, O Come All You Faithful. Sing, all ye bright host of heaven above. Glory to God, all glory in the highest. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ. Be seated. If the ushers will come forward, please.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank Thee, Lord, for this opportunity coming into Your house tonight, Lord. Just on a birthday of Jesus that we are here. The reason for the season. And Father, we know that each and every one of us have had a wonderful day. We just thank You for the day itself. We thank You for all the gifts that were given. But the most precious gift that was given to us so many years ago in the birth of Jesus Christ Himself, who came later, Lord, to walk amongst us, to pay a debt that we couldn't pay on an old rugged cross, to defeat death in itself and be our risen Savior. We just thank You and praise You for that opportunity of being in Your house to reflect upon His life, Lord, and to thank and praise You for all You have done for us. And we ask now, Lord, as we take this offering, that You would give it, or that we can give it freely and open-heartedly, Lord, and use it for the upbuilding of Your kingdom. For it's in Your name we pray and ask. Amen.
As we light the final candle of the Advent wreath, we're reminded of Christ.
We find two verses of Scripture in Luke chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord."
Jesus was born in the midst of threatening times.
Jesus grew up to be a light to many people, first to His own Jewish people, and then to untold numbers of people around the world.
There are things in this world that frighten or threaten us. There are things that we simply do not understand.
But through Jesus Christ, we find the answer to real and lasting peace.
In Jesus, we have hope.
Thank you. And I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor, four, the major, lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. A couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place where you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. The shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Continue reading in Luke chapter 2, continuing on with verse 12 in that chapter. And this shall be a sign unto you, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God, and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. Hope. Everybody needs hope. A man approached a Little League baseball game one afternoon. He asked a boy in the dugout, "What's the score?" And the boy responded, 18-0. We're behind." And the man said, "Wow, I bet you're a little discouraged." And he said, "Why should I be discouraged? We haven't even gotten to bat yet." Hope. Everybody needs hope. Hope, as God's word uses it, is a word of optimism, an expectation that looks forward with anticipation to the future. The word hope is like turning on a light in the darkness. It's like bringing joy into a sorrowful situation. It's like introducing life into a scene of death. Life without hope is pretty bleak. That's what Paul meant when he wrote these words in 1 Corinthians, when he said, "If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are all most miserable." In other words, if this is it, if this is all we have to look forward to, oh my, oh my. You see, this life is at best very, very brief and full of trouble. And if all your hope is tied to only what happens in the here and now, what a miserable life it would be. I want to briefly share with you three reasons Christmas is an appropriate time to celebrate the hope that is ours in Jesus Christ. Reason number one, Christmas reminds us that God's in control. You and I know and believe in the virgin birth because we have the whole account recorded in God's word. But only Mary and Joseph knew it at that time. Put yourself in their position. Questions of how can this be? And then the fear, the confusion, the doubt, the interrupted plans. But it was in the midst of all that uncertainty, all that confusion and fear that God spoke a word to them, assuring them he was in control. That's what every one of us need. That's precisely what you and I need when our lives are filled with uncertainty, confusion, doubt, and fear. And all of us, because we live in this world, we will experience any of those four things somewhere on the journey through life. Just as God knew what was happening in Nazareth, in Bethlehem, and on the journey to Egypt, he knows what's happening in your life. He knows what's going on at home. He knows what's going on at work. He knows what's going on at school. The knowledge, though, as Christians, that our God, our Heavenly Father, is in control, that nothing catches him off guard, is one reason we can live as people of hope. Amen. Reason number two, Christmas reminds us that God can. God can do what? Anything God wants to do. That God did fulfill prophecy when Jesus was born, that he did create life in a virgin womb, tells us nothing is too hard for our God. In fact, the angel Gabriel, speaking to Mary about what was going to happen to her, let me just read two verses in chapter 1 of Luke, verse 31 and verse 37. Again, the angel is speaking to Mary and says, "And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. And then verse 37, for with God nothing shall be impossible. The Christmas story, perhaps better than any other account in God's word, reminds us that God can, and is another reason we can live as people of hope. Reason number three, Christmas reminds us that God cares. The Christmas story reminds us that God cares about anyone and everyone, and that includes you, and that includes me. The shepherds were the most unlikely to hear the good news of Jesus' birth for two reasons. Number one, they were social outcasts. Why? Because they were poor, uneducated, doing a job nobody else wanted to do. Secondly, they were religious outcasts. They were considered ceremonially unclean. In other words, they were not welcome at the temple. They were not welcome when the other people of God gathered to worship, because it was their work that kept them away from all the religious feasts and festivals and special holy days. Well, why couldn't they go to that? Because somebody had to watch the sheep. So they couldn't get away. So therefore, they were not welcome with other worshipers. But then there's also the wise men in the Christmas story who represented just the opposite. They represented the educated, the rich, the elite of that day and time. You see, the shepherds represented the Jewish world, and the wise men represented the Gentile world. From the beginning, Jesus came to be the Savior of the whole world. He came to be your Savior. He came to be my Savior. Jesus loves you and will forgive you of your sins and give you the promise of eternal life in heaven with Him when this life is over on this earth. How do you do that? How can you know that you're ready to leave this world when that time comes? It's as easy as ABC. A, you must admit to God and to yourself that you're a sinner, and there's nothing you can do about your sin problem. B, you must believe that Jesus Christ is the answer to your sin problem. That Jesus came to this earth, born to a virgin, lived a life without any sin, went to the cross, died on that cross for you and for me. They put him in that tomb, and on the third day he arose, getting victory over the death. And then C, confess him as your Savior. Accept the gift, in other words, that God freely offers to whosoever will believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. In just a few moments, we're going to gather around the Lord's table to remember. To remember why Jesus was born. He was born to die. To die for you, to die for me, to die for anyone and everyone. His body was broken, his blood was shed, so that we might have hope. As a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you can live each day knowing God is in control. Nothing that happens to you catches God by surprise. We need to remember God can do what? Anything God wants to do. And then we need to remember nothing is impossible with God, and God cares. You are somebody important to God. We want to take just a few moments before we have the Lord's Supper to do some personal examination, as God's word commands us to do. I'd like you to just bow your head right there in the pew where you're sitting. And if Rita will just come and play softly on the piano. In these few moments, you may be here and you've never been saved. You've never accepted the gift of salvation. made possible for you through Jesus Christ. We invite you to come. But Christians, this is a time when we look within and we confess any and all unconfessed sin to the Lord, asking Him to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Let's take just a few moments of silent prayer as we prepare our hearts to receive the Lord's Supper.
Larry, would you ask God's blessing on the bread, please?
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, the Creator of all creation, the Creator of the greatest gift that anyone could ever receive, Jesus Christ. You brought Him forth, lowly and in a manger. You followed Him all the way through to the cross. And He followed your will. Even though He asked you if there was any other way, but your will, not His, be done. And He went to the cross. And the most horrible thing, He bared my sins for me. All of our sins were placed upon Him. What shame and humiliation that must have been for Him. And we're thankful that you brought Him back from the dead. That we may have hope, we may have love. And that's what we're doing here tonight. Remembering Jesus died. This is His body that He gave for us. But you brought Him back again. He is alive today. Father, we thank you for this greatest gift man has ever received. And these things we ask in our sweet, pleasant, holy name. And as always, your will and not ours be done.
Thank you.
God's word tells us the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me."
Father, it's with humble hearts that we gather around this table of remembrance tonight, Lord, reflecting on the blood that was shed with Jesus. As his body was beaten and broken and his blood shed, it was his blood then and his blood today, and as long as there will be time, Lord, that will wash our sins as white as snow, as we accepting you as our Savior. Father, that is the only true way that anyone can ever know you and have an eternal existence. Father, we praise you and thank you for that gift of life. But most of all, we thank you for that gift of salvation, that gift of an eternal life. And we remember it now, Lord, through this blood. For it's in your Son's name we pray and ask. Amen.
Thank you.
God's word says, after the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. We're getting ready to do the candle lighting at this time from the Christ candle. What a challenge for us, though. We live in a dark world. But you know what an opportunity for Christians. Because the darker it is, the smallest little light can make all the difference. So as the room begins to light up, starting with one candle tonight, think about that. Think about the challenge. I'll leave you with a verse where Jesus told all of us as his followers, words found in Matthew 5, you are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven.
The stars are brightly shining, it is the night of a dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, nine divine, oh, night when Christ was born, oh, nine divine, oh, nine, oh, nine divine. Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother,
and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we. Let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Then raise his name forever. His power and glory evermore proclaim. His power and glory evermore proclaim. Let's all stand together, please.
Fall on your knees, O hear the angel voices, O night divine, O night when Christ was born. Oh, night divine, holy night, oh, night
divine. Now, before we leave tonight, let's all sing together Silent Night.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon flies, all is light, shepherds hear the angels sing, Alleluia, hail the King, Christ the Savior is born.
May God bless you and keep you. May you be quick and eager to share the love of Jesus with others that you encounter on a daily basis. Merry Christmas. God bless. You're dismissed.